Well, welcome. I'm glad everybody could be here today. This is our third speaker series in our multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary cybersecurity initiative sponsored forums. And it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. James Nolan. He's with Analytical Technologies at Decisive Analytics Corporation, based in Arlington, so he's close by. Dr. Nolan leads a world-class team of mathematicians, computer scientists, engineers in the development of patented text, video, audio, and data fusion capabilities, which we all know is really important to fuse information across particularly unstructured data to gather more understanding of what goes on, particularly in the cyber domain. And then these systems are deployed now worldwide in the military, intelligence community, and in commercial systems. We've all seen the different types of hacks, and it's in these days trying to understand the analytics at wire speed and be able to understand latency as a figure of merit that you looked, how quickly can we do this? Dr. Nolan was the 2007 recipient of the Tibbetts Award for his achievement in transitioning statistical techniques for the intelligence analysis to the Department of Defense. He also serves as an adjunct professor of computer science at George Mason University. Dr. Nolan holds a PhD and MS degrees from George Mason and a BS from the University of Maryland. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Nolan.
Thank you, Dr. Walker. Thank you, Dr. Walker, and thank you everyone for being here today, for taking time out of your day to listen to my talk. As Dr. Walker said, I'm from Decisive Analytics Corporation in Arlington, Virginia, and we primarily do applied research in the aforementioned areas, as opposed to probably most of the research that you do here on a university campus, which is tends to be more basic research and fundamental research. However, we do partner with universities across the country to develop and transition those basic technologies to more applied and then operational systems. So my talk today, I'm going to talk a little bit about machine learning techniques and applications, and I'm going to spend quite a bit of time talking about the problem and some of the problems that I see. And my hope is that I can inspire some of the folks in the room to tackle some of the problems that are out there that we see in industry and academia. So the outline of my talk is going to be as follows. I'm going to talk a little bit about the problem and the motivation, some opportunities that I see for machine learning, and these are areas that are still in their infancy, some problems where we're still looking for good solutions. I'm going to talk a little bit about two machine learning techniques that we've been developing for quite a while at Decisive Analytics. I'm going to quickly go through how we've taken some of those techniques and applied them in the real world. And then I'll talk a little bit about what we're doing to build a machine learning API. Okay, so the problem that we are tackling is how to handle this sea of data that exists out in the world. And this data is generated at an unseen pace. Every day we are able to develop, we as a community are able to capture and develop more data than ever seen before. And that data can be in many forms. And this is certainly not a complete list, but it can be in unstructured text like emails and chats and from the web. It can be from our own personal document collections. It can be from social media. It can be from imagery and video. You know, now today everybody can go buy a GoPro. And we can go out on the ski slopes and we can generate, you know, 5 or 8 hours of video per person. We were never able to do that before. And then there's also structured content that resides in traditional databases. And so what is our real problem? Well, our real problem is that our ability to collect data far exceeds our ability to turn it into useful information, and that's an important term that I'll get into. There's several reasons why, but first let me get into those definitions. So I want to distinguish between data, which is the raw stuff that we collect from whether it's a camera sensor or whether it's cyber logs or whether it's video data, is the data that it's just quantities, characters, or symbols on which operations are performed by a computer. So it's the raw data. And what we're trying to do is turn that into information, which is the knowledge obtained from the investigation, study, or instruction of that data. And the big problem right now is for us to get from data to information, for the most part, is very labor intensive, because we require human beings to do that, because human beings are very good at fusing a lot of information. You know, what does it mean when somebody tells you that their gut is telling you something? You know, I feel this way because my gut is telling me something. Well, what that means to me is that what that human has done through their visual systems, their hearing systems, they've fused a lot of data to come to some conclusion. And to do that automatically with using computers and algorithms is very difficult, and right now we struggle with doing that. Just to give you an anecdote, I was talking to the program manager for the Air Force Intelligence Surveillance and Reconnaissance program, and he has analysts who spend their eight-hour day, they look at seven UAV video streams that are all going simultaneously, real time, and their job is to identify important things that happen. So imagine that that's your job, that you have to come in and do. And this program manager, he admits, I think they can do that for about 15 minutes before they get too tired, too exhausted from that. Okay, so, but really, why do we have this problem? And this is just my opinion. we love things we can touch. Right, we like things that we can set up, that can collect, our cameras that we can put in our house to watch. You know, I can watch my dogs while I'm driving up 95 to Delaware and see how they're doing at home. We can collect stuff on our iPhones, on our cameras. We are putting up satellite systems and ground systems like never before. You've heard of the nano satellites, the smaller small sats that people are putting up, and they're able to put them up more cheaply than ever before. What took a nation to do, you know, even 10 years ago, now private companies can put satellites into space and collect data. And then, of course, network collection devices. You know, at Decisive Analytics, which is a relatively small company, we've got about 150 employees. I talk regularly with my IT person, and he was telling me, you know, over a weekend, we have 2 million cyber events that happen on our network. And he has, you know, how do you get through 2 million events? It's very difficult. And the problem, again, just my opinion, we do the analysis with software. It's not as sexy. You know, everybody likes the GoPro. Everybody likes an iPhone. Everybody likes something you can touch. You know, we do a lot of work with the military, the general officers. They like to see sensors. They like to see stuff that's launched into space. When we show them the analysis of algorithms or the output of algorithms, that's only now starting to become a little more sexy as we move into this world of big data. Until we can take all that data and get it into some kind of database where we can then start to execute algorithms to analyze that data, we can't do much, right? Until we can get it into a format, take that unstructured data and get it into a format that we can run our algorithms on, it's really not very useful to us. Who here has heard of the Panama Papers that just happened this week? Okay, so the Panama Papers, I was listening to an NPR story last night. The Panama Papers is 2.6 terabytes of data that they got from this law firm. To give you an idea of the scale, the WikiLeaks data was 1.7 gigabytes. And you know, we're only now hearing, does anybody know the background of how we got to where we did this week with the Panama Papers? Okay, so how we got here was that 2.6 terabytes represented 11 million documents. There have been 400 news reporters from 109 news organizations that have been reading those documents for a year. That's what it took to get to this week, where suddenly we have, you know, the Prime Minister of Iceland steps down yesterday because of a relationship that he had with an offshore bank. And I, as a computer scientist, and I'm sure everybody here in the room, is thinking, well, why couldn't we just take that 2.6 terabytes and pump it through some algorithms and spit out relationships and spit out topics and all that kind of stuff? We ought to be able to do that in hours, right? If not minutes. So that's what I think about. Yeah. But be careful. Don't go download the Panama data set because it's it was illegally obtained. So that still makes it illegal. Okay. So consider the problem. You know, one of the problems, particularly with the Panama data set, why is it so big? Why is it, you know, the WikiLeaks data was 4 million documents, and it was only 1.7 gigabytes. Well, the Panama Papers are 2.6 terabytes, and it's 11 million documents, roughly 2.5 times the size. Well, it turns out the Panama Papers are pretty much all scanned PDFs. So somebody took documents and ran them through a scanner, which produces a PDF, which is essentially an image, which makes it, for the amount of data that's in there, it makes it huge, right? So this is one of the problems that we struggle with, is how to take data like that, that's been, you know, maybe not collected in such a smart way, and be able to extract information from it. So consider if we took a well-formed document, like a document that's in a text form that we can easily get to the text. How can we identify useful information from that document? Things like the title, the body, other metadata like who it's from, pictures that represent logos, pictures that represent captions. And a particularly interest, a problem that might be of interest to this group, it's of interest to the intelligence community, and it's of interest to the financial community. How can we extract quantities from these documents automatically? So, you know, if an analyst says, you know, the expected earnings of IBM are expected to increase by X percent, how do we automatically extract that? Or if somebody represents a list of companies in a table with their earnings data, how do we automatically extract that? How do we know it's earnings data, right? We know that as humans because we look at the document, we see it visually, and we can fuse that we're looking at earnings data. For a computer, it's a lot harder. Okay, so now consider this when the documents are ill-formed, like what happens with the Panama data, where we've got scanned data sets. Or now consider it when you're a law enforcement agency that goes into a house and gets somebody's disk that has all kinds of scanned documents on it. So this is a real problem that we are tackling, is how to handle this data problem, and we call it data wrangling. How do we get this data into a format where we can understand it, where we can get algorithms to understand the meaning of the data? All right, so just to quickly go in some of the areas where I see opportunities for machine learning contributions, where are things that I've seen that come from either the government, the R&D topics, or through our conversations with some of the financial customers that we work for. And I group these into natural language processing, text mining, and then I'll talk a little bit about imagery and video processing. So some of the problems that I see out there are intelligence corpus summarization. So how do we take a large corpus of data, like a Panama Papers size corpus of 11 million documents, and understand what's in that quickly. Boy, wouldn't I like to be, you know, the news organization that could have taken that 2.6 terabytes of data and pumped it through and gotten a summary of what was in there and identified all the relationships that were in that data, and I could drill through that and find interesting things. I would imagine I could do that in probably a week or two if I could get that data processed instead of a year with 400 journalists. Relationship extraction. This is a big problem of taking unstructured data and being able to take mentions of users and identify how they are related. For example, Dr. Walker and I are related to one another because we've exchanged a lot of data with one another that describes that that I'll be coming here to give a talk. And you all share relationships with one another because you communicate with one another through email and through text, and you talk about the different kinds of topics that are of interest. That are of interest to you. So, one of the things that I think needs to be done is to automatically be able to take these large corpora and identify the who, what, the why, and the how of the relationship types and why they exist. Entity extraction, disambiguation, and resolution. This is the problem of Sam giving a document that talks about Starnes Walker, Dr. Walker, Mr. Walker, being able to resolve that to a single entity that we know that we're talking about the same person. and being able to do that intra-doc within documents and inter-doc across documents within a corpora. Being able to identify events and label them. So there's a lot of unstructured data that is generated that talks about a lot of different things, and it's one thing to be able to summarize those documents. It's another to be able to identify particular events that are being discussed about, like, you know, for example, today's event. There's posters that have been presented. There's emails that have gone out. How do I identify that that's a particular event that is occurring? And then also, more importantly, being able to understand what is the nature of that event. Is that event going to occur in the future? Has that event already occurred? That kind of stuff. So those things are all very difficult to do. And we react very differently to them, right? If I'm a law enforcement agency and I'm interested in some kind of criminal activity, I'm going to react differently to that event if it happened in the past versus whether it's talked about being occurring in the future. And our ability to process language and understand that is very difficult. Some of the imagery and video analysis problems that I see are, anybody here have a GoPro? Take GoPro video, take video with your iPhone. Well, it turns out that depending on the source of the video that you take, whether it's from an overhead, like an airplane, or from a satellite, versus a surveillance camera, say at a train station, the type of video that you collect really drives the type of algorithms that you should execute on it. For example, if I take algorithms that have been, all my algorithms have been trained, right, to do some kind of analysis. If we take algorithms that have been trained on surveillance video and apply them to video that's been captured from an overhead asset like a plane or from an unmanned system, we're probably not going to get very good results. So one of the things, one of the areas I think for research is to be able to automatically identify what is the source, what kind of scene are we looking at, and then routing those algorithms, routing those scenes to the right classes of algorithms so that we can get good results. Because believe it or not, right now we kind of have a one-size-fits-all view when it comes to imagery and video algorithms. Text detection and extraction. So one of the unfortunate things that happens not only the intelligence community, but also in the financial community, is that we tend to build final products that have metadata, quote unquote, burnt into images or video. And we sometimes lose the actual associated metadata. Like, for example, where was this image, where is this image or video taken? And so there's a big appetite for being able to automatically rebuild that metadata once that product has been disseminated downstream so that so that we can make those images and videos discoverable. Scene understanding is a big problem that is related to an agency that Dr. Walker and I were talking about, the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. That's the ability to be able to take imagery and video that's captured either overhead, handheld, or by any device, and being able to understand the nature of that feature. And in the state of the art today, can do about as well as being able to differentiate between identifying things like roads, vegetation, buildings. What we need to be able to do is get down to a higher fidelity level of detail and be able to identify types of roads, how many lanes, elevation of that road. These are the kinds of things that our military is looking for. Yes, sir, question? I'm not familiar with it. I would guess that it is, but. Okay, so semantic change detection. You've probably heard of change detection. Somebody wants to know when there's a particular scene, things have changed. For example, construction, right? There's been a new building that's been built. I look at the scene at one time. I look 5 years later, a new building has been built. Well, it's pretty easy for us to identify the change. What's much more difficult is to understand what is the change that has occurred, and we call that semantic change detection. So, being able to look at that scene and being able to automatically identify that, yes, there was a change, and the change was that that the building was built, or, for example, a bridge has been taken out due to some flooding occurrence. Okay, and then more difficult problems are things like object detection, relationship extraction, being able to look at a scene and identify what particular objects are there. For example, law enforcement intelligence is very interested in identifying things like weapons, types of weapons, gang logos, that kind of stuff. And then commercial entities are more interested in identifying things like logos. For example, if you watch a sporting event, right, like a tennis match or a golf tournament, what do you see all day? You see logos. If I'm a sponsor of those golfers or of those tennis players, I sure would like to know how much airtime my logo is getting. Right now, they can't do that. And what is the quality of my airtime? How frequently is my logo well featured on the scene? Exemplar search. So I've got, I talked a little bit earlier about how we've got an analyst who has to look at 7 live streams of unmanned video. What if that analyst is usually looking for something? Right, and they usually know what they're looking for. What if we could just feed that into the system and just queue up to the analyst anytime we saw something that matched what they were looking for, a certain type of vehicle or a certain type of motion? Action recognition, being able to identify certain actions, like somebody is in the shooting motion or somebody is exchanging a package with somebody. And then overlay removal. Actually, one of the big problems that we have is in image processing and video processing is that we treat every pixel as if it's part of the scene, and many times it is not. because we burn in a lot of the metadata, like the geospatial coordinates, the source, the resolution, that kind of stuff. And what happens? Our algorithms detect those as objects, right? Because they stand out. They stand out pretty well in those scenes and cause a false alarm. And to our actual algorithms that do detect things, it's a detriment because it makes them perform less well. All right, let's talk about two machine learning techniques that that we have implemented over the last few years. I'm going to talk about statistical topic modeling for document summarization, and then I'll talk about semantic role labeling for relationship extraction. Okay, so statistical topic modeling used for summarizing a corpus of text. So here's the problem. We've got a whole bunch of data that we are provided. It could be any source of data. It could be the WikiLeaks data. It could be the Panama Papers. And we want to understand what all that data is about. And statistical topic modeling is a technique that's been around for a while, where we can take that data and through the use of the generative model, we can statistically identify the topics that exist in that corpus. So for example, here I've got a bunch of documents. We run it through the algorithm. We spit out some topics. You can see the first topic here is about baseball. The second topic here is about crime. And the third topic here is about the new iPhone price. And then because people tend to write documents with multiple topics, we can also characterize the topics that are within a document. And what does this allow people to do? Well, it allows them to quickly sort through a large corpus of data and see what it's about. So we've applied this to intelligence analysis. We've applied it to financial analysis for those that want to trade on the news. And what it allows them to do is they can take a large corpus of data, and with their education, their background, their bias, what they're looking for, they can go through the data and they can identify things that look normal, things that look abnormal, and they can drill down quickly into the areas where they would like to spend their valuable time doing their analysis of the data. So what is a statistical topic model? Well, if I've got a whole bunch of documents, it can be defined as a broad concept or theme, semantically coherent, which is quote unquote hidden in documents, for example, politics, sports, technology. And we represent that as a probabilistic distribution over words. So the way that it works is we take in an entire corpus, we build a vocabulary, the vocabulary that we've seen along that entire corpus, and then we probabilistically map the documents to a distribution of words. So, just to reiterate that, let's just take a simple example. Suppose that we had documents that are comprised of just five words. We've got a small vocabulary. We represent the topics that exist over the corpus as a mixture of those vocabulary words. So you can see here we've got three topics, topic A, B, and C. And topic A is primarily about words 1, 2, and 3. Topic B is primarily about 2 and 3. And then topic C is primarily about words 4 and 5. And then documents are also represented as mixtures of topics. So you can see that if we take a corpus of documents, say we have four, we can see that document one is mainly about topic B, a little bit about A and C. Document two is mainly about A and C. Document three is mainly about C. And document four is mainly about B. And the beauty of this is that at the end of the day, this is a clustering technique that allows us to take documents and assign them to different clusters with associated probabilities, or you can think of them as weights. So here's just an example of what that mixture of topics might look like. Here we've got a few sentences that I won't read to you, but you can see that it's a mixture of three topics, one primarily about a government response, and then about the city of New Orleans, and then the relief donations that are being brought to that community. And here's just an example of what those distribution of words looks like. You can see here we've got different topics that are about arts, budgets, children, and education. And the important thing to note here is that each topic has the same vocabulary of words. What's different is their distribution or their weights associated with that topic. So you might see some overlap in words across these topics. That's normal and to be expected. And here's how those topics are assigned, can be assigned within a document at a finer grain level. Turns out we can take these same techniques that we have applied to text and we can apply them to images and videos. If we treat the features that we identify from images and videos as word vectors. So we can do things like automatically build captions for images and videos, or we can automatically index images and videos. Okay. Now let's talk a little bit about semantic role labeling, our moving beyond simple topics. So the technique that I talked about previously, statistical topic modeling, is purely statistical, is language independent for the most part, just treats words as tokens, so it doesn't really matter if you're working in English or you're working in Arabic or Chinese or French, with the exception of, there are some nuances to languages, but for the most part, it's language independent. Semantic role labeling, what we're going to talk about is how we extract relationships from the data. And this is highly language dependent and not language independent. So semantic role labeling. The whole idea here is that we would like to be able to take large amounts of data and we would like to be able to identify the relationships. Think about the Panama Papers again. What did the reporters do over the last year? They pored over that data to find interesting relationships, right, with these offshore bank accounts because they wanted to identify possible illegal activity or unethical or immoral activity that politicians were doing. And it took them 400 man years to do that, right, over the course of a year. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to do that automatically. We're trying to identify those relationships that exist in that data automatically. So the whole concept is the basic unit of communication is the sentence. For example, I've got a simple sentence here. I saw the man buying food. When we say a sentence like that, or when I say a sentence like that, I hope those of you in the audience, it evokes basic concepts that you think of that are in that sentence. So for example, we see when we use the word buying, we think about commerce. When we say the word saw, we think about perception. And it turns out there's a resource that exists called FrameNet. It's an ontology. You might be familiar with WordNet or PropBank or VerbNet. These are all similar tools. It's an ontology that describes different types of concepts that we use to reason over and extract relationships from unstructured data. And each frame has a set of roles associated with it. So when I talk about the concept buying, There are roles associated with that, like things like a buyer, money, goods, and a place. And then when I talk about perception, there are things like a perceiver, a phenomenon, a body part, and a manner. And the challenge is that we want to be able to look at these sentences and automatically map the roles that exist there. And if we can do that, now we've got a new way that we can explore the data and we can present it to people. And rather than having to have somebody read over 400 man years read 11 million documents, we can do this in, you know, however long it takes us to compute it, right? Which should be a fraction. So here's what that process looks like to do this semantic role labeling. The first thing that we need to do is we need to tokenize the sentence. Then we need to identify sentence boundaries. Then in parallel, we do things like identify parts of speech. We lemmatize to normalize the sentence. We do word sense disambiguation so that we can identify the meaning of the sentence. For example, when I use the word bank, am I talking about a riverbank or am I talking about a financial institution? And then we parse the sentence, we build a parse tree of the sentence, and then we can perform our semantic role labeling. And I just give you some examples here of some labeled sentences where we identified different roles, and they're highlighted in the different colors. If you look at this first example, CERN smuggled the undocumented containers from El Sam to Galag. We've evoked the concept of smuggling, and then we've identified the roles of the perpetrator, the goods, and the source. And so you can think about how, from an intelligence perspective, or from a financial perspective, or from an investigative reporting perspective, how useful this kind of technology could be. Okay, and as I talked about, there's a resource called FrameNet that we use. It's open source. It's from UC Berkeley. They love to partner with people, and they're developing language models for the government for government-specific activities and events. So, as opposed to the last techniques, statistical topic modeling, which requires no ontology, no prior model, it's a generative model, learns from the data. This, however, requires some kind of lexicon or ontology behind it, and so that is labor intensive. And then we can do things like that. We can once we've done the semantic role labeling, we can do fun things like construct networks of relationships. So we can see how folks are related to one another. So here we can look at this sentence and we can identify where Sirhan lives, what he has bought, other organization that he is related to, and so on and so forth. So it's a real powerful tool for this kind of analysis. Okay, with the remaining few minutes that I've got left, I'm just going to walk quickly through some of the specific projects that we are doing at Decisive Analytics. So this is specific to the company I work for, but we have a broad range of applications, and I hope that it inspires you to think of some areas that you can contribute. So one of the things we're doing is we're doing automated relationship extraction. So we are trying to do what I talked about on the last set of slides, being able to take that large corpus, automatically extract the relationships. And the thing that we're doing differently than others are doing, I mean, you can download any NLP tool and like Stanford NLP and do entity extraction. We're doing relationship extraction through topics. So how are people related, you know, because they participate in things together is our focus. We're identifying events, and we're really focused on this problem. We're assuming that somebody can identify events well. We're not tackling that part of the problem. The part of the problem that we're focused on is the polarity, the modality, the tense, and the genericity. So did it happen or not? People talk about a lot of events, right? That doesn't mean they happen. Modality, is it speculative or is it a stated fact? You know, did it happen or did it not happen? Tense, did it happen in the past, present, or future? And then how specific is it? You know, do they talk about an event that's going to happen in April? Do they talk about an event that's going to happen on Wednesday, April 6, 2016? Semantic search. So we have a client that wanted to know anytime somebody talked on social media about a bomb. Anybody ever search for a bomb on Twitter? You get to all kinds of crazy stuff, right? My girlfriend's the bomb, I just did a Jaeger bomb, this cake is the bomb, and then, oh, every once in a while, somebody talks about a bomb left at the airport or something like that, right? So we told them, hey, that's great, we can help you with that, but here's the problem, right, as I just described it. And so what we're doing is we are, instead of doing simple indexing based on keywords, we're looking at the words around the word that we're interested in to identify the context. What context are we talking about? And we can filter out that noise, filter out the meanings of the mentions of bomb that have nothing to do with an explosive devices, and focus on the ones that do. One of the things that Dr. Walker is intimately familiar with in the military and in the commercial markets, when we're building a product for our boss or our commander, they love PowerPoint, right? Everybody loves PowerPoint. It gets delivered in a PowerPoint. Well, it turns out that most of that construction is manual. So we are developing techniques where we can build templates of products that users are interested in. And then as we go through this automated pipeline processing chain, we can automatically populate that PowerPoint or that Word document. And then an analyst can go in and just tweak it for their particular commander or customer. Scene classification and text detection, we're focused on being able to extract embedded text from imagery, turn it into metadata, because unfortunately many of our downstream partners are not provided with the metadata, things like coordinates and timestamps. And we're providing that to them. Multimodal entity extraction and management. This is a big problem. What do I mean by multimodal? Well, consider if I'm tracking a ship, right? I might get data on that ship that might be taken from an image. Ships provide data, AIS data, not always truthfully. There's also manifest data. There's vessel data. And then there's other kinds of sensor data. So being able to take in all that kind of data instead of looking at one mode and fusing all the different modes together to do entity management. Okay, so this goes back to one of my earlier concepts that I talked about is diverse data. So this goes back to the scan PDF problem. So being able to look at hundreds of thousands of scientific, technical, and other open source documents to identify topics and entities and relationships that are of interest in varying formats. So, and also getting back to the problem of being able to identify quantities and units that exist in that data. And what do those quantities mean, right? If I'm a financial analyst right now, today, financial analysts get reports every day from many financial institutions about how corporations are performing. They don't have an automated way to understand if that report is telling something good about a company or bad. And actually, good or bad is not good enough. They need to get down to the quantities and the units. You know, we expect this to do 10% better in the next 3 months. That data is very difficult to extract. Technology tracking, this gets back to what Dr. Walker and I talked about, supply chain issues. So being able to search, archive, and extract relevant information about your technology programs. Where is your data, are your parts coming from? Who are your suppliers? Are any of those suppliers at risk, right? If you look at some of these larger military programs, they have hundreds or thousands of suppliers. And if one of them can't perform, that can put your entire program at risk. So they want to do things like being able to monitor open source news and identify relevant snippets of information that should be bubbled up to identify any kinds of issues. And then we do all this in a cloud environment. So we do this down the road for our friends here at Aberdeen, which I understand we share in common. We transition a lot of this technology into the MapReduce and Hadoop stack. You see some of the capabilities listed there that we've talked about. And then one of the challenges that we're working on is once we've processed all this data, how do we visualize it? How do we present it to a user in such a way that's meaningful? How do I take 11 million documents, summarize them, do entity extraction, identify relationships, and then present that to a user? Because I can't put all 11 million documents. I can't put the multiple of entities and relationships that I've identified, because they'll explode, right? I just can't put those on the screen. And then one of the focus areas that we're working on right now is to build an open source machine learning API. We're doing that for a few reasons, not only from a business perspective in the sense that is the direction that the community is heading in, but we also think that it's best for us and it's best for our clients to build a community out there that can contribute and use our API. And I just wanted to provide a little insight into how we're doing that. We're taking these different capabilities that I've talked about, and we're categorizing them in different modules. So we have things like data wrangling, which handles different formats, dirty formats, the PDF problem I talked about, different imagery, video formats, and data normalization service. And then we have our imagery and video processing capabilities and our NLP capabilities. And as we go through our research agenda and we develop these capabilities, each individual capability, which I've got here in the smaller boxes, we roll those into our machine learning API and we make them available to our clients. And one of our big focus areas is how do we make that available? And we know that we need to make that available at scale. We know that out of the gate, we need to be thinking about how are we gonna make this available for a real-time problem? And that real-time definition varies by client, right? It all depends on how much data do they get in per unit of measurement, whether that's a day, an hour, or a minute. and then how quickly do they need those results? Whether that's a day, hour, or a minute. And so we make this available for them to incorporate one of two ways. They can incorporate it through analysis and visualizations, or they can also incorporate it inside their workflow via access to the API. And that's all I have. Like we have about 5 minutes for.
We have time for questions, so offer some questions here. So, Dr. Nolan.
Yes, sir.
For the machine learning API that you mentioned, once it's available, once it's ready, how would some public like us find it, access it, and use it?
That's a good question. We're still in the early stages, so we're still working that out. I would imagine that we would make it available to university partners, you know, through our relationship here with Dr. Walker. We could make that available. We're still trying to figure out how we make that available, and more importantly, how we support it, so that once we make it available to users, because we do want to get it out there, we want to have people bang on it and identify the problems and issues and provide us feedback that we can incorporate into it.
Thank you. For the modeling, topic modeling from the corpus, it seems to me that you have pre-trained topics with associated term distributions. Is that correct?
No, that's not correct. You might be looking at the labels that I have on there. The labels are put on after the fact, after we examine it.
So you mine topics and word distributions from the corpus?
Right. It's all automated. And then we provide that to a user who looks at it. You would look at it, and then you would say, oh, okay, that's about arts, that's about politics, that's about sports.
Oh, okay. So how do you find the sort of, how do you segment the documents? For example, I think there are mailing documents that have multiple topics, so you might need to segment that and then train topics within different segments of the documents. So how do you do that?
Well, you bring up an interesting point. So if there are multiple topics, it will identify that. That's one of the foundational properties of the algorithm. But one of the issues for an algorithm like this is, it looks corpus-wide. So if I have a corpus of documents that are like news articles, 500 to 1,000 words, let's say, and I mix that with a corpus of tweets, which are 140 characters max, right? You're going to get some funny results, and your results are going to be biased towards those long documents. So one of the things you need to be careful about is that the corpus that you're looking at makes sense, right, for it to be together.
Okay, thanks.
So to expand on that, when you have a topic that has two things that are deeply ingrained, so for example, you had one topic where it was talking about somebody stealing something, and then another topic talking about Apple's new iPhone and the price. So what happens, for example, if you have a topic where someone stole an iPhone, where these two things are interrelated, but
right,
they're still kind of separate topics?
Right. That's good.
So how do you separate those?
That's a good question. So it would depend on how much data we have that describes that act versus the other acts. If we had an equal amount of data, it would most likely show up in both topics, and hopefully create a third topic that focuses on stealing of iPhones. If we had an equal amount of data. If we just had, we're looking at this is a document summarization technique. So if there's one event that's separate from, say a million documents, if there's one document with something going on with a million documents, you're most likely not going to find that one document. What you are going to find, though, is if you had a million documents and 50,000 of them were assigned to this one topic and you missed 100, it would put those 100 with the 50,000, so you wouldn't miss them. Does that make sense? Yes. Right. That's a good question. There's actually a technique. I had it buried in one of the slides. You probably didn't see it. It was up there in the upper left-hand corner or upper right-hand corner for you. There's a technique called topics over time where we can take advantage of the temporal information, and then you can see things ebb and flow over time. And that's important for identifying new things that are emerging, right? Whether that's a new threat, or whether that's a new technology, or what have you. Now, one of the challenges, the big challenge with that is, if I'm doing this automatically, how do I get that time right? that's in the document. That time is embedded somewhere in the document. And many times I have to distinguish between the date the document was published and the date of the event that it's talking about. They're not always the same or similar, right? That's one of the things you need to watch out for.
Do we have any more questions?
Yes, sir.
What new fields do you see emerging as a result of this data analysis, new data analysis group becomes more widespread?
Well, I see more of this technology being applied commercially. So there's a lot of things that I see that we just don't have time to work on, like the logo recognition problem. And you mentioned one earlier, you know, is Facebook using this to identify the different background parts of images? There probably are. But I see this being applied commercially for brands. And then being able to do things like micro-targeting. So you take a place like Times Square, which is just, it's got cameras everywhere, right? If I'm you see the people out on the street, right, trying to get you to go into their store, right? If I can look at your clothing and I can see your Abercrombie & Fitch logo on your shirt, maybe I can send you an ad to your phone for 10% off at the Abercrombie & Fitch store as you walk by it, right? Or Nike or whatever to try and understand that. It can also be applied to things like social media, like Instagram. I know there's a lot of companies that would be interested in identifying logos and other features that are in images and then being able to automatically caption those so they can see, what are people posting about the brand, right? Many times, the old saying, an image is worth 1,000 words. Many times those are posted without any words, right? Why did somebody post an image of, a Tesla, right? Is it because they love Tesla, or is it because they had, part of the drivetrain problem that Tesla had, right? I wouldn't say it was processing power. I would say it goes back to my original thesis for the talk, which is we're able to collect far more information than we are able to process. And the reason that we can't process it is because it takes a lot of time to build good models to process it. It takes a lot of training data. It takes a lot of analysis of the results of those training data, and we're just able to collect more data far more easily than we can do any of that. That's where the hard work is. Yes?
I have a question about user adoption of these tools. So I can imagine the user, when he has human beings comb through a bunch of documents or drug smuggling,
right,
they can say with confidence there are 40 incidences of drug smuggling in the Panama papers.
Right.
When you plug the documents into these algorithms, you're not 100% confident that everything's being caught or captured.
Correct.
And how do users feel about that, and what do you say to them?
They don't like it. We get a lot of user rejection. Usually you need to find how do we handle it. How we handle it is we try and find that one super user who sees the benefit, and if we can get that super user to adopt it, and usually that super user is trusted by his peers. If we can get the super user to adopt it and trust the technology, and explain to everybody that it's not perfect, right? I mean, we can tell them that it's not perfect as technologists, but they don't trust us. If we can get that super user to adopt it, we find that moves a lot of obstacles out of the way. And if they can understand it, it's trust but verify, right? Trust it but verify it. And then if we can move a little further, and then they can have some success for it. For example, we had a case study where we worked with an agency where they had They had 20,000 documents. They had a bunch of people over weeks identify a terrorist cell of eight, or they identified eight documents that identified a terrorist cell. And it took them several man weeks. We took that data, and within 30 minutes, through the topic modeling, we identified all the topics. We organized, one of the topics had those eight documents and a ninth one that they had missed. You know, when you show them one that they missed, you know, you get a lot of people going, oh, this looks like it could have promise. Now, we won't always do that. You know, did we get lucky? We probably got a little lucky.
Well, we're going to have a reception following this, but again, let's thank Dr. Nolan again for an excellent discussion and talk.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.